My name is Mike Morris, and I'm with Storm Surge, and many of you, I hope, are familiar with us by now. We've been putting on these programs for about 3 years, and we're basically raising awareness to some of the changes that are being motivated by climate change, and one of those issues, of course, is sea level rise, which is impacting our shores, as well as climate-enhanced storm activity and bigger waves and that sort of thing. So tonight's program, we'll just put it in the context of that whole issue, is that, you know, we have rivers that eventually find their way to the ocean. And they have what is known as an inlet. And these inlets naturally like to meander and snake around, depending on what the waves and the weather are doing. If you're faced with a situation where you have increased storm activity and rising oceans, you want to understand how these inlets work and how they're going to react to those forces. Because if you're having a problem with an inlet, or if you want to tweak it, you really have to understand how it works. Otherwise, you can't manipulate the system to have it work in your favor, for example. So the Merrimack is an engineered inlet. If you go back in history, the inlet used to be further south, like near the tip of the basin, at its southerly extent, and then on the northerly extent, sort of up where it is now. And that meandering used to take place in a 50 to 100 year cycle, based on the review of, you know, nautical charts to go back into the 1700s. So, but that was a problem, of course, for shipping, and Newburyport was a major commercial harbor, so the Army Corps put the jetties in to kind of keep that inlet in one spot so that ship captains had a dependable channel to go through. But that has created some other issues. And so what I hope to do tonight is, I will introduce Irene Watts, but what I hope we'll see is how this inlet has changed through history, and also the changes that were incurred once the river jetties were constructed. Because if we can understand what the river is trying to do, and how it's sort of struggling against these rock structures that we put there, we can kind of understand what's happening to the shorelines on either side of the Merrimack. So I want to introduce Irene, and she's got a really long CV, which is like 5 pages, so I'm not going to go through that. But she is a doctoral candidate at the Florida Institute of Technology. She's got a very strong background in coastal geology and shoreline processes, and she's studying Sebastian Inlet in Florida, and she's going to draw some parallels. And prior to her going to the Florida Institute of Technology, she was working for the Army Corps up here in New England, and actually studied the Merrimack River Inlet. So she is, I think, an expert in that. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Irene.
Thank you. Thank you for that introduction. That was very nice. And thank you all for coming. I'm really excited to be able to share some of this research with a bunch of people who live here. And I live on the beach in Florida. I've grown up on the beach, so I definitely understand all the concerns. So this paper was something I presented in Coastal Dynamics in 2012 or 2013. Actually, the reference is there for you. You can actually download it for free. And simply just Google the title. It should come right up for you. And what I wanted to do is to go through all the historic charts that I had compiled and see what I could learn from them in order to examine the changes through time that the inlet had done naturally before jetty construction, during, and then after. It was supposed to be my dissertation, but what I ended up doing is moving to Florida and finding another inlet that had a lot more data to it so that I could do a lot more different analysis with it. So the way that I've constructed this talk is I've split it up into two main sections. I'm going to cover the paper itself, which is essentially the evolution of Merrimack Inlet, and then provide some lessons learned and from other places in the country that may be applied here to move forward. And these are just photos that I took back in 2011, and actually you can see a gentleman fly fishing off of the spit that was actually growing off of the distal end of Plum Island. I've given a couple of different talks to different groups of people, including the NCOSI group, which is a systems engineering group, mostly a Department of Defense, and they work with trainers for helicopters and airplanes, and nobody had actually been to the beach. So I wanted to break everything down into two main elements. We have forcings, and then the responses to those forces, and that's what we're seeing with beach change. But what complicates things and make things fun for me is that both of these elements, forcings and responses, are changing with time. So you have a continual feedback loop. So in order to get a picture of what's going on, you really have to look at the system through time, or you're just looking at a picture with most of it blacked out and you're only looking at a section of it. Kind of like looking through a viewfinder with half of it being blacked out. So this is a graphic I've unfortunately been using for years, and I've managed to lose the reference originally, but it really shows all the different processes that happen on both a time scale as well as a spatial scale. And what we're mostly interested in, what everybody wants to know, is this large scale geomorphology change. What happens in the long term? What's going to happen in 10, 20, 30 years? But a lot of our measurements happen on this mesoscale, so meso meaning hour, day, or meter to kilometer, and most of my numerical models also operate on this month to year time scale. So we're continually trying to get down to this large scale, long term morphology change. So I feel kind of silly talking to you guys and giving you a site overview. I'm going to do it anyways, just to kind of give you some of the terminology that I'm using, and then if I'm wrong with something, please correct me. And I've split up the historic bottom topography, which is just bathymetry, into three main sections, pre, post, and then post-extension. And I stopped the analysis in 1928 after about 4 or 5 months of digitizing charts, because I really had to get back to the Sebastian Inlet. And in order to kind of provide a modern-day synthesis, I also have some bed forms with LIDAR, which is light detection and ranging. It's a useful remote sensing tool for us in the coastal industry to be able to very quickly and for a relatively low cost take a small light aircraft and fly over the coast, sending lasers down to the surface. And it's a great mapping tool for us. So this is where we are in the world, and I'll mostly be focusing on Plum Island itself, Salisbury, to the north. And this is actually the wave rose that's coming off of the buoy. You have a great directional buoy that is operated by the Coastal Data Information Program at Scripps Oceanographic Institute. And it provides clean, deep water waves. So for future analysis, this is a great data source. It's been out there since about 2008, I believe. And you'll notice that this is denoting both frequency occurrence, so the number of times waves are coming towards the buoy. And you can kind of imagine the buoy being at the center measuring waves. But you have a bunch of it coming from other different directions that are also in higher energy. Question?
Where is the buoy?
It's located directly offshore in about 76 meters of water.
Offshore,
it's on Jeffrey's Ledge, 50 miles due east of the buoy.
Thank you. Perfect. To note, this is a mesotidal inlet, so you've got 2 meter tidal flux here, which is a little bit different than what I have in Florida. I've got micro. And your significant wave height measured is about 1.3, and that's just a statistical parameter that we use in coastal and ocean engineering to express an average wave height. So going on to the fun stuff, there's 185 years of data available beginning in 1828. I know that there are some other individuals out here that may have actually more than that, that I can actually add to my database. And I've kind of ended the analysis at 1920. What I wanted to do again was to demonstrate the importance of historic documentation. At the time of my career, when I had first started looking at this, a lot of people were throwing out data and charts, and I went, what are you doing? This is excellent. Why would you get rid of it? But it needs to be digitized and analyzed properly so that you're not going beyond the capability of those data sets as well. And I wanted to examine the relationship between the different morphology features, the different sand bodies, to changes in the inlet configuration. And this chart on the right is the 1826 harbor of Newburyport in the mouth of Merrimack Inlet, and that's essentially my time zero that I'm working with. Yes?
The Plum Island is somewhere right outside. Does that correspond to anything on Plum Island today?
I think I'll get into that, though. The question was whether or not this Plum Island corresponds to what it is today.
No, not what it is, but any part of that, of the deep part, is that the current ocean side, is that the whole point and things that like, what of that, if you had today's map, would you line up?
I think I have that on slide 27.
Oh, right.
It's coming. You've got to the dessert part of the feature. So again, the question was looking at, how well does this island here and Salisbury to the north correspond to what we have today? And that's what I'm getting after. Oh. So you know exactly where I'm going with this. Right. Very good. And so again, we have some limitations with this. This is historic measurements. There's error in any sort of measurements, but you know, these are lead lines. These surveyors were excellent surveyors, but at the time, it's simply a lead line off of a boat. And you have variations in spatial coverage and density. And this is what really was the crux of me not being able to do the research that I wanted to do for my dissertation, is that you see on the 1880 entrance to Newburyport Harbor, the points, each one of these little black dots, and you're not supposed to be able to read them, but you know, it's really confined to about the mid-island area and then just up to what that is the proposed jetty at the time. But this one has a much, much larger coverage. And so as I stepped forward in time, it was really difficult to be able to make any sort of trends by constantly having your size change. So I could never really pick one or two features that I really wanted to look at in order to be able to do any sort of volume change. So I'm going to take a moment and talk about the digitization method. So I'm using a combination of ArcGIS Spatial Analyst and AquaVeo's Surface Water Modeling System. And what I'm doing is starting with an orthorectified aerial image, and all that means is that I know in space, in the world, where it is. And so there's actual coordinates within that aerial image. So this is Massachusetts GIS 2008 aerial image. And what I do is that I use Spatial Analyst to provide real-world coordinates to the original charts that have been scanned and digitized. From there, I'm able to bring that chart within SMS in order to manually, and this is why I took it four months, put in every single point that was actually in the chart as well as the survey lines. And so it took about 4 months to do all that. So I'm able to, each point has a XY, so a latitude and longitude, as well as a water depth associated with that. And from there, I can make a surface. So what you're looking at is just the digitized surface of that chart. Cooler colors are going to be indicating deeper water depths. Warmer colors are going to be indicating shallower water depths. For all of the charts that, moving forward, they will look like this, I have a black line that's indicating the zero mean high water contour, and that will be my zero mark. I had to pick something as zero, and that's what I chose to go with. So, now on to the fun stuff. So, on the left panel, you have 1826, and in the right panel, you have 1851. And I'm going to focus on four main areas that really kind of jumped out at me as things that I thought were interesting. To the north, this is Salisbury. You have this recurve spit that is oriented this way to the southeast. And then you have Plum Island having this sort of a drumstick shape. What I thought was most curious was the natural inlet throat is tipped to the southeast, whereas, you know, not very long after, it's starting to rise to the north. And again, this is before any sort of jetties or anything were constructed, so this is purely natural variability in the inlet. And you'll see, notice that Plum Island changes shape rather dramatically, as well as Salisbury to the north. And so continuing further through time, 1851 to 1878, the channel is continuing its migration northward, and this recurve spit continues to change shape as well as Plum Island. And you have this dog wag of a channel, again, moving towards the north. And then, unfortunately, this is where what started to really frustrate me, is that some of the charts didn't really have any data consistently through time. So I was starting to lose what the shape of Plum Island was, particularly in this time step. Moving forward again to 1878 to 1880, right before the jetties were constructed, and this is what was there before the jetties started to be constructed. You again have the inlet throat more or less perpendicular to the shoreline, and then it starts wagging towards the north. So I thought this was fascinating, as not only you have the shoreline changing as well as all the different sand bodies within the system changing. So to kind of bring all four of them together, you notice that it has this variation that spans 54 years, where the inlet throat, the actual natural throat, is migrating between a southeast orientation to a northeast orientation. The north shore within Salisbury is moving from this recurve spit shape and then actually starting to go back into the estuary. You see this deflection into the estuary as it's starting to extend more into the shape that we see today. The ebb shoal itself was not clearly defined, and what I mean by that, it's not the characteristic giant piece of sand that you normally see at a lot of different inlets around the country. It was kind of these breakers. It was actually referred to as breakers within the charts. You have a potential downdrift attachment point both here as well as in here, and you have some material that sort of looks like flood channel marginal bars, which provides a transport mechanism for material into the estuary. So you always have that connection between your ebb shoal feature as well as your flood shoal feature, and sand is passing back and forth as your tide is rising and falling. So is there any questions to this point? Yes?
Scale in meters or yards or feet or what?
I've provided a small scale here of 2.7 kilometers.
The color code,
I'm sorry. That ranges from 0 to about 33 feet. All of the numbers are in feet, mean low water, and the mean high contour is highlighted. So it's kind of tough to, because I didn't want to overwhelm with too much information. So, but I try to be consistent between all the charts so that we can see what we're looking at. So let me move on to post-jetty construction. It was almost kind of during jetty construction. So on the left panel is the first time step in 1883, which is when the jetties initially were constructed. You see this to the south, you see a small portion of it to begin construction, but most of the north jetty had been constructed at this time. And you see an impoundment of material to the north, and Plum Island, and I'll refer to this as a distal lobe, begins to try to take shape here. But you see that the deflection of the channel kind of remains fixed. And then by 1884, which is only a year later, you notice that this shape is much, much different than that shape. And so Salisbury continues its extension back into the inlet, or into the estuary rather. And then by 1884, you see material impounding on the south side of the south jetty as that island continues to evolve. Moving forward, stepping year by year, almost 1885, you see that this shape continues to extend back into the inlet, and then you get this kind of dip within Plum Island, which is kind of reminiscent of what we see today. And the inlet's actually, or the jetty rather, is almost full to the south in terms of its impoundment, and the impoundment kind of continues to the north. And by 1889, and again, this is what frustrated me with lack of data, this would have been really neat to see these types of shoal migration. This shape continues to walk back, and that the distal lobe of Plum Island continues to extend into the inlet itself. And then when you put them all together, you can kind of see that what's interesting now is that the throat of the channel has maintained its orientation rather than wagging back and forth like a dog tail. But the Plum Island continues to migrate, and as you go backwards, this is a blow-up image of the 1851, or I'm sorry, one of the other charts, but you notice that even back then, before jetties were constructed, because construction began in 1883, you notice all of these shorelines walking back through time, it was already eroding and extending into the estuary. And I was fascinated by this, and unfortunately I don't really have a good answer as to why that was occurring. I have some ideas moving forward. And to kind of just step it through it, and you can kind of watch everything change. They're, for the most part, pinned together so that they are, you can kind of watch as it evolves naturally through time. So I only have two time steps with a jetty extension, and what I mean by that is the this extra leg that was extended off of the south jetty. And you'll notice that the inlet throat, the natural channel, has started to have this kind of kink in it. And I'm not quite sure as to whether or not they had started dredging that or not. It was not clear to me in my records. You notice that Plum Island starts to take its characteristic shape that we have today, and Salisbury starts to flatten back out and extend again into the estuary itself. And you can still see these types of cycles today. And this is a comparison between the time step right before the jetties were constructed in 1880, and this is orthorectified on top of one another. You notice again this material is gone and extended back into the estuary, and the characteristic shape of Plum Island is a little bit different than we have today, but it's still within the realm of possibility. And this is really kind of the dessert I mentioned before. Ah, yes. When I first did this, I thought I did it wrong. And actually, there's a great paper that was recently published by Chris Hine and Duncan Fitzgerald and a few other colleagues that confirmed this, where the inlet itself, the actual natural mouth, had migrated northwards by about 900 meters. And they got about 1,200 meters, so that works for me. It's within the realm of possibility. So you'll notice that the this opening simply has moved north. All of this material has extended back into the estuary within this time frame. Yes?
Salisbury land that's outlined in red, and when we migrated down to Plum Island,
okay,
claimed it, and the state said, no, it's now no longer yours, but it's moved. Is that true? Did you read that?
I have not come across that particular piece of information. The question was whether or not this an individual had owned property in Salisbury and then the material had moved south, and I think maybe a gentleman may know.
Well, I think the rumor I heard was that the law said that the boundary was the middle of the river. Where right. The hell the river was.
Right, yes, yes. So he lost the land and it added to new reporting was the cracking from Salisbury, which is what this map shows.
You go to Nancy Weir's book.
Yeah,
I don't know where it was.
Right.
Talks about that court case.
That's what I thought.
But basically, the ruling for Massachusetts was the property eroded from Salisbury. The sand disappeared under the water and went to the Delta Bar. Mm-hmm. And then it found its way back to shore, but on the Plum Island side. And because it had disappeared under the water, yeah, that's what made the ruling.
Do you know that book by Nancy Weir?
I have not read it, actually, but my analysis was really limited to the nautical charts themselves, because that's what I was mostly interested in. Well, yeah. So that's fascinating. That's interesting. I enjoy that. So you can get a lot from aerial imagery, and this is actually all from Google. You can sit there and take the, there's a button up at the top that allows you to kind of step forward through time. Yes, another.
So is slide 57 a prognostic slide that shows what it's going to look 50 years from now?
I don't have that, and actually I would love to be able to show that to you. And the question was, do I have a slide or an image that will show 50 years from now? And no, I don't. And I really wish that the, and I'm hoping that the community of practice is able to develop new technology in order to be able to make those, that transition from the mesoscale, for the month to year, up to a decadal scale. When you run geomorphic models, and I'll touch on modeling in a moment, and it's really difficult to get it to go over that hump, computationally speaking. And I know that there's some people within Coastal Hydraulics Laboratory as well as in Delft in the Netherlands that are trying to make that progress, but it's still highly experimental at this point as far as I know. But so the purpose behind this is that you can simply go through Google and look at its evolution through time, and it's really quite dramatic. So whatever variability was occurring before, whatever forcing, if you think about the first slide, that forcing is still continuing, and so I'm really fascinated by that, and I'm hoping that future research will be able to highlight and figure out what that forcing, that variability is, so that we can adapt with it. Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, question.
When you did your analysis, 1820, there was a jetty built on the river side of Plum Island. Did you come across that have any?
The Woodbridge Island dike?
Exactly, dike.
Right. I did see it within the charts. I don't.
That didn't impact any of it.
I'm always hesitant to say anything that it won't impact something, because invariably, like Dan Hubbard before me, may say that, you know, I've chosen poorly, like in Indiana Jones, when you take the wrong glass, and maybe someone will figure out 5 years later that it'll 5 or 10 or 20 that it may have an impact. But I did notice it in the charts. I didn't really know exactly when it was constructed. I had a really hard time nailing that down. So I'd be curious to see it. I think it happened before 1826.
Yeah,
1820. So when I 1826 was my zero mark. So in order to be able to make that or answer that question, I need a couple of time steps behind that. So but it would be interesting.
What, you saw it there in 1826?
Yes. The Woodbridge Dyke was already constructed in 1826. It was constructed in 1820. Yes. So to bring it now forward in time, so I mentioned LIDAR, light detection and ranging. So what I wanted to do is to, again, get at these forcings without actually being able to go out into the field. At that time, I wasn't able to go into the field. And you'll notice a lot of different things just by looking at the 2010 LIDAR, where you have this ebb-oriented feature, so you can imagine the tides pulling this material out into the ebb shoal complex, as well as these flood-oriented bed forms, so you see how they're concave into the inlet itself, and you know that that's flow going back into the inlet. So it's not a simple nozzle on a hose where it's not unidirectional, it's all not going on at once. There's a lot of different pieces of the puzzle going on. And you notice that you have some ebb-oriented bed forms. I'm not quite sure if it's the contrast is enough. But you can see that they're concave downward to the right, so you know that there's some force. state park for the most part. Highly popular, one of the most visited in the state. We have commercial fishing, recreational fishing. This down here, if you can see it, this is the intercoastal waterway. But what I want to note is this is not a federal channel. It is maintained by the Sebastian Inlet District. It was formed in 1919 with the mission of maintaining an open navigable channel. The channel was artificially opened using dynamite directly into the coquina, which is a type of shell hash material. It's a hard rock, and it is, so we don't scour because there's nothing to scour to. But the support comes primarily from property taxes. And they're really passionate about being able to not only understand the inlet, but manage its resources effectively in order to maintain that navigable channel. And they are chartered by, or they're directed by the state of Florida to do that. They do get some funding from the state of Florida, but primarily their funding source is tax-based. So they have partnered with Florida Institute of Technology, their Coastal Research Process Group, in this comprehensive field campaign, which analyzes and supports those management missions. So these are all the different data sets that we collect. So I'm very busy. But we have a real-time bottom-mounted ADCP to the north, which allows me to post on that webpage that I showed you earlier that it's the wave height, wave direction, current direction, as well as current magnitude and water level. We also have a real-time meteorological station with a water level gauge, which is also very important for anybody that's trying to traverse the inlet. We have biannual beach profiles as well as bathymetry surveys, aerial imagery. We provide an annual sediment budgets and other projects by request. Full sediment characterization, over 1,000 sand samples were taken, so I know where different pockets of larger grain sediments are to smaller grain sediments, which is actually really important for the numerical modeling. But this is all done by students. Like me, and this partnership has been going on for over a decade now, and the inlet we work very closely with in order to support some of their management decisions, like do we need to dredge the sand trap, and then if we do, where do we place that material. So it's really enabled them to be able to not only give them products to the public in terms of what are the waves doing that day, but also be able to effectively know what's going to happen in the inlet if they do make any sort of changes. So some tools of the trade. Again, the ADCPs, this is kind of what it looks like. It's a bunch of transducers that looks up into the water column and it sends sound through the water column in order to be able to calculate those wave heights and current directions that we're interested in. And that's what it looks like before I get my hands on it. They all come in all sorts of shapes and sizes. These are all Sontex. This is an RDI workhorse Sentinel, and this is a Nortec Aquadot. So this little guy is here. And then this big guy is over here. This one is now real time, and this is a colleague of mine. And basically that is an aluminum pole driven into the sediment by a jet plow. And it has been stayed there for 15 years now. So it's been a really effective, and it's actually quite fun to dive. The other tools that we have in our arsenal when it comes to being able to understand longshore sediment transport is the longshore sediment transport flume. This is an example of a physical model. They're coming back into popularity. This is actually at CHL, and it's really kind of neat where you build a beach and you have a flybridge, and all of these different poles, uprights, are actually current meters and wave meters, and you drive waves towards the beach, and then you collect the sand and measure what's actually been transported. So you really directly able to understand what happens cross shore in terms of its erosion and movement of sediment. So, but before anyone thinks that all I do is dive in Caribbean blue waters all day, this is what it looks like normally. So it's I actually can't even tell you which one that is, but for those of you who are divers, it's actually a really easy, simple lift bag. You just lift back the bag, the new one down, and pull the old one up and pull the batteries off. The batteries generally last for anywhere between 6 to 9 months. We like to go down on kind of a monthly to two-month basis to scrape it down. We have a great biofouling and corrosion control research group at FIT, and we like to work with them in order to understand what material grows on what in order to kind of keep it down, because a lot of that actually stings and it gets inside of your wetsuit. So I know that there was some interest regarding the ADCP that may still be in the inlet or is in the inlet. This is one of my frames. It may look similar to that. I do paint it blue as camouflage. We have a lot of people get really excited, I think, and salvage my units, and then I don't have any data. But so that's generally what they look like. Everybody does theirs a little bit differently. And it's simply you have a battery pack and you strap the ADCP to the upright. So if you don't have a pole and you need to go the concrete route, you can do concrete. And I just poured these into, those are just mixing tubs, and I bolt the frame down on top of it and just pull everything up when I'm all done. So that's what the three of them look like side by side. When they come back up, I know that there's some concern, like why should we even bother looking for this gauge? As long as the canister has not been breached, there should be data inside. This was hit by an anchor, and I brought it up in pieces, and it was still actually pinging, and so it was actually still trying to take data while it was bringing it back up to the surface. And you can see some of the, this is generally what they look like when we come up, and biofouling really is kind of a problem. So I mentioned some of the biannual topography and bathymetry surveys. We have a combination of multi-beam and single-beam, continuous since 1989. And this data set is really what is so important to us to be able to make those sediment budgets and be able to make those long-term projections of what's going to happen through time. And the multi-beam is the darker areas here where the point density is so small that you can't differentiate between them. And then you have these cross-shore beach profiles that extend up onto the beach. And again, this data set is pretty much what's very important to us. In order to facilitate my personal research, I want to get after the carbonate fraction movement. In order to do that, I need much more surveys rather than just biannual. I need to do more of a monthly to several weeks basis. And so I was supported by Coast and Harbor Engineering to outfit a personal watercraft with a survey unit. This is simply a fish finder. This is a hummingbird. I now have a different unit. But it allows me to get essentially X, Y, and Z, and I have an accelerometer on board where I can back out the math in order to get me a surface, and then do that several times in order to actually measure the sediment transport without having to use streamer traps and other really labor-intensive methods. And this is not a new technology, it's not a new approach. Stevens Institute's been doing this for a number of years, and Land and Sea Survey, this is our partner surveyor, and they put about $500,000 into this, and I only put about $1,500 into mine. So, but you can still get a lot of really high quality data at different cost points. So what you're kind of staring at here is essentially my dissertation, where each one of these squares represents one or two different ADCPs, and I'm able to understand the hydrodynamics across the inlet along shore, so I can understand the differences in currents from the north of the inlet to the south of the inlet. And actually I've gotten one really close to the ebbshoal to look at the interface between a wave dominated area to the north that you would have to a more tidal dominated area. There is an interface there that I'd like to try to resolve. So I have a total of six ADCPs out with a real-time met tower, and again, those repeated bathymetric surveys via jet ski. So all of this is going to help support my modeling efforts, and this is what the model looks like. I use the Army Corps' coastal modeling system. It is a combination of a wave model and flow model that allows me to calculate these processes here, and the information is passed to the flow model. Sediment transport, salinity, and morphology and hydrodynamics are calculated, and then the information is passed back to the wave model, and it runs in that sort of fashion. It is extremely fast. It runs on a PC. It doesn't, I don't need a supercomputer, I don't need a Cray. It would be nice to run on that, but I can't really come up with a reason why. But essentially that grid up to the top looks like this when you extend it into 3D. This is actually a different publication from a colleague of mine, but it really just shows how important that bathymetric data is, because I need to resolve it within the model correctly, or else I'm not gonna get the right answer that I'm looking for. So bringing it back to forcings and the result of those forcings. So you're seeing three panels here. On the left panel you have the wave height and wave direction vectors. So the colors are indicating higher wave heights. The blue are indicating higher wave heights. So you notice that the higher waves are right off of the inlet itself, and the lower waves are within the estuaries. That kind of makes sense. But the arrows, which unfortunately didn't come up very well, are indicating the direction of those waves that are coming in. So that's your, one of your drivers for sediment transport. So the center is going to be your processes. So our wave heights have remained the same, but the current direction is maybe different. It may be not quite the same as the waves. So, you know, you have to ask yourself what's going on. And so your result is your sediment transport vectors, and I've actually displayed those on top of the depth contours, so you can see that you have this recirculatory pattern, you have local reversals, and all of these data sets here are in the same timestamp within the model. So it's all happening simultaneously. So this may work. We're going to give this a go. I try not to do animations within PowerPoint presentations because they invariably don't work. But this one seems to have worked. It's highly accelerated. It doesn't actually operate that quickly. But you'll notice that, you know, this is an inlet very similar to our own. It's not. It's Sebastian Inlet. But you'll notice that you have these local reversals onshore. You have some variability going north and then back and forth to going south. See, we have this capability here to be able to understand what happens, but we need to have the combination of good field data, comprehensive field data over a long period of time to get to this point. So to kind of,
any evidence of the Gulf Stream current in any of these findings?
The Gulf Stream is actually extremely important for what I do, and I was actually trying to get at using the Gulf Stream as a proxy because for sea level rise, because it actually will, in combination with onshore winds, we have a high and low stand of sea level of about a meter. So at several times over the year, our water level is a meter higher than normal, and then it falls back down. And then you have some upwelling and other processes that are driven partially by the Gulf Stream. So yes, it is extremely important. And that's what's really neat about working at that particular site. So you don't really have that one here, although I'd like to make a note on the North Atlantic Oscillation, which is a sea surface temperature variation that operates in a couple of decadal years. And when I first saw that variability of the inlet, that's the first thing I thought of, is you have this variation. And I sat in George Mall's physical oceanography class, and I was completely blown away by larger scale variability in things like sea surface temperature as well as pressure differentials that have an impact on storms, which ultimately will have an impact on the shoreline. So I think as coastal engineers, we need to bring this together. So again, to kind of summarize and some closing thoughts before I open up the floor to discussion and questions. Again, field and analysis methodology that has been used at other inlets like Sebastian Inlet can definitely be used here at Merrimack. And if there's questions on the waves and the currents, measure them. I encourage, instead of wondering what they're doing, just simply measure them. It could be a short period of time, but a longer period of time is a much better way of going. I know this is a really energetic wave environment, but there's a lot of different ways you can still put gauges out and then get a good return on data. Again, investigate the larger geostrophic variability, and unfortunately there's no fast answers, but I think that there's great potential. So you have the great potential to partner with schools, other research institutes that are here. You have a great knowledge base here near Boston, Woods Hole Oceanographic, Provincetown Center for Coastal Studies. All of these places have people who love to do this on a daily basis. I'd like to tell people I like to watch sand move and they think I'm nuts, but that's what we love to do. So I'd like to open the floor to any questions or comments and discussion. Yes?
I know you don't know yet, but could you speculate what you think the area would look like if the jetties were never put in?
The question was to speculate on what the area would look like if the jetties were never put in. And the best answer I could give you is that the variability would have continued unabated, as I showed in the previous slides, on as that channel kind of wagged back and forth like a dog. Dan Hubbard actually said it very succinctly that it's very likely that a lot of the land wouldn't be there. The entire inlet could have kept migrating north and it could have migrated back south. So, you know, it's a question of that understanding that force that drives it would really be the right kind of question to go after first in order to be able to understand that. Yes?
What are some of the factors that drove the selection of Sebastian versus Port Canaveral?
The question was why Sebastian over Port Canaveral. Are you referring
to the effect of jetties?
For my research. Couple of different answers. That one must actually do the research that one's being paid to do. So as a starter, because my funding comes out of that. So I'm funded by the Sebastian Inlet District to provide them with that wave data, and so it's kind of a good one. But I don't really know anybody up in Port Canaveral, but my advisor, Dr. Gary Zarillo, has been working with Sebastian Inlet for, I think, over 10 years, and the person before that was Dr. Lee Harris, who unfortunately passed. But it's not as special as this inlet is to me, but it's still a very special inlet, and I've enjoyed it greatly. There's another question over here. Yes, sir.
Is there anything beneficial when you guys dredge the inlet at all?
Dredge the Sebastian Inlet?
The Merrimack.
I don't actually know the answer to the question. The question was, is there anything beneficial of dredging the Merrimack Inlet? And I haven't actually been involved in the dredging of the inlet. I was mostly interested at the time when I was working at the Corps, the sediment transport around the inlet. So I don't actually have a very good answer for you. Yes?
Benefits of either, you know, freezing the state of the channel as it is or letting it flow the way it wants.
The question was, is there any economic benefit to letting the jetty, the inlet, essentially do whatever it wants to do? I don't actually have the answer to that one. It's more, it is beneficial to keep a inlet navigable. I definitely think, actually, it's not so much the economics as a safety factor, because you have a very important Coast Guard station here. And I believe the Coast Guard started here, if I remember correctly, and which is very neat.
Right. But wouldn't the volume of water that's coming down the Merrimack River keep a channel? I mean, the channel would change where it is, but wouldn't there always be a reasonably deep channel?
The question is, with the volume of water that's coming out of the Merrimack River, keep the channel open. The reason why the jetties were put in, and if you look at the historic documents, that they were having a really hard time getting through the channel, and they were running on top of the breakers, and there's some fascinating notes. I really enjoyed going through them, where the surveyor was actually frustrated because it was changing so quickly that he kept having to go back and measure it again and again. So the purpose of jetties is to actually turn up, it's like a nozzle and a hose, it's a little bit more complex than that, but it's speeding up the flow of water through that jetty to keep the channel clear, or try to keep it clear. Yes, question?
There've been a number of current studies, some of which have had no current conclusion. Is what you subsequently began to understand from your work in Florida in relation to the fact we seem to have a number of agencies who are pursuing directions which really don't seem to be, how shall I say, coherent?
The question was more on a policy and a collaboration basis between different agencies. I'm completely out of the federal system, but I do keep in close contact with my colleagues, both at New England District as well as the Coastal Hydraulics Laboratory. And that particular question, I don't really have an answer to, but I know that there's a lot of collaboration between agencies, in particular NOAA to the Corps of Engineers, and then NOAA also collaborates with, Sebastian Inlet's highly collaborative between the Park Service as well as the FDEP and Sebastian Inlet District itself. So you have that passive information, and as well as needs and understanding the other person's needs as well, from a park basis, in order to keep it safe for tourists, as well as keep it safe and navigable for the fishing community, which is extremely popular down there. But I don't really think I can comment on the current workings of different agencies. Yes.
The study that you have been working on with the Corps, I know there were some different scenarios that you were testing out, and some of them looked at modifying the jetty and so forth. Mm-hmm. And I was wondering if any of those had any promise, or is there anything that...
I unfortunately kind of set it up, and I had to start my dissertation with the way that funding kind of happened. I basically set it up, and I had to start my dissertation, or else I would have lost the funding. So I don't actually know the conclusions of those, and I know that studies do continue, so.
Yeah, there wasn't really a conclusion, that was a problem, and it's supposed to be.
Yeah, and I'm really happy to hear that.
That study you're referring to, I mean, the tools are there to do that study, but one of the things that caught my eye was the wave rose that she showed from the Jeffries Ledge movie shows a completely different wave angle than what they fed into the model. And so if you're making your baseline assumptions incorrect, then whatever comes out of what you're doing isn't going to be right. Yeah. So,
although those are also like one of the stations.
Well,
the other thing too is that you only look 6 months out. Okay, if we change a jetty like this, what happens in 6 months?
Well, right.
This is a much bigger thing. It takes a little bit longer, a lot longer time for it to readjust itself. So aside from what I thought was an accurate wave data going in, that was just one element of it, and then not looking far enough into the future, you couldn't really make a decision on various configurations. That was kind of a good question.
Yeah, I mean, there was a lot of issues with how it demonstrated, it didn't demonstrate what we were observing.
Yeah,
it didn't, you couldn't. One way to test a model is to feed historical data into it. If it comes out the same way, then you know the model is working properly. And as you say, it wasn't doing that. So there were some issues with the model. Mm.
Yes.
The video you showed about Florida with the wave action equations, how long did that take and could they do it up here?
They definitely can do it up here. This is the same model in terms of the actual engine that they're using. It's both a coastal modeling system. I just happened to set it up for Sebastian for my purposes here.
How long did it take?
How long did it take to set up?
Yeah.
For Sebastian, I can't really give you a good number because the couple of students before me have been running this model for over, I think, five or six, seven, probably longer than that. So I had a model grid to start from. It's the model grid that takes so long. That's the real time, but it can take a couple of months just to set it up. When I do a model job professionally, I like to at least have 6 months to simply set up and bring the data together and set up the model, and then the model will actually take about 5 to 8 days to run.
Was it publicly funded or privately funded?
The model itself is publicly funded. It is your tax dollars at work, and you can actually download the model and use it. The graphical interface is a private commercial software package. So, yes, sir. Yeah, I'll let it run. The question was, can I narrate this slide? I'm actually going to see how far this thing goes or not. There we go. So what you're looking at is the different color contours are going to be your bottom topography. So it's actually the surface of the seafloor. And the arrows that are flipping around in all different directions, those are your sediment transport vectors. So it's indicating where sediment transport is moving towards. So it's giving me an indication of how it's flipping around. So what's interesting is actually in this section here, if you just kind of focus your eye on a few arrows, you can see it's actually going back and forth. And the reason I did this particular animation for the Sebastian Inlet District is because they were interested in local reversals. We all knew that it happened, we just didn't know at what time scales it happened and how frequent it was. And this was actually a surprise to us. The question became, this section here, you'll notice that it's a little bit deeper, it's a little bit greener, that's actually our sand trap. We've removed material from the sand trap and placed it downdrift of the inlet in this area here. I'm forgetting which R markers it was, but they wanted to know, well, was that a good place to put it? And is it getting back into the inlet? Is it moving farther down south? Is how fast is it moving it? So that's what they really wanted to get to, but we can't ask those questions without this much data. So did that kind of clarify it for you, what you were kind of looking for?
Yeah,
that's awesome. Okay, cool. Yes, and behind you.
I'll
get back.
Tides doing here?
The question was regarding the tides.
Yeah.
This one, and unfortunately, and I'd love to have the programmers do that for me and allow me to have like a little area in here to show me what part of the tide cycle it is. And they haven't been able to do that for me, but I have some really good friends who are awesome programmers, so I'm hoping to come up with something. And this is what's really important is finding graphical software, and we don't actually have that yet, in order to communicate not only to the public what goes on graphically so we can have cool animations like this, because they say so much. You know, I can stand up here and talk until I'm blue in the face, but really a photo or an image or an animation is really what drives home the concepts. But we're continuing to develop software and different data analysis packages that will allow us to communicate those ideas and for me to understand it really rapidly, because a lot of this does take a long time to do. So, but that was a very long-winded answer to your question, I'm sorry. Yes, sir, in the back.
What's the time period of the data we're looking at? I mean, is this hours, weeks, months of...
I believe this is a one-month simulation. Let me restate that a little bit differently. I always run my full model 6 to 9 months, and so I just took a piece of it because it's a really large video file. So one must not anger the PowerPoint. Yeah. Yes, sir.
When the vectors shift, that's actually the tide changing, right?
It's a part of a product of the tide as well as the waves, but the arrow itself is indicating sediment transport. And that's what's really neat about this graphical tool, is that it allows me to pick and choose which piece I want to see. It's just really difficult to get those three panels together and have anybody be able to see the arrows. So another question, yes?
In the case of the Merrimack, where would the data come to run a simulation like that?
There are some data sets from some of the LiDAR data sets that I had showed before that does give you a surface, but really it needs to have the same data sets that I showed earlier. It really needs something like this, where you have a combination between, these are a combination of beach profiles and single beam surveys, so it's much like my jet ski where it's just a single beam of sound going down, it's not a multi-beam. This is a much more expensive rig through here where we're towing it, so the district has decided to only do multi-beam in this area for cost requirements. But really to get at that model, you really need something like this repeatedly. And we take this every twice a year. Once in the summer, once in the winter, and so what essentially I do is I run the model from those survey dates, and so I'm always consistent through time, so I know how good is the model replicating the environment, morphologically speaking.
So there's no existing data that could be applied?
There is some existing data sets that can be used. This would definitely be what you would strive for, but in order to get at it now, do a couple of surveys and you could be on your way. Yes, sir.
Coming back to the inlet animation.
Yes.
I noticed on the narrow part of it when it's running, there's a sediment moving in and out.
Narrow part. Let me get it to start running here.
The arrows keep changing direction right in the inlet.
Yes, in the inlet throat.
So yeah, that is sediment moving.
That is sediment moving.
Do you know over time whether it builds up or leaves? In other words, or is it constantly?
It's actually that this inlet is, it goes back to data, and this is the only reason why I know this, is that the sediment, once we dredged the sand trap, a lot of the sand started to fall out of suspension and start filling the trap in, and that's what it's supposed to do, is that it's supposed to be a sand reservoir for us in order to mine it. And actually, the Sebastian Inlet took the material out of here and placed it south of the inlet to renourish one of the beaches. They also planned a reserve, they put it upland, so they have a stockpile of their own sand. So the material is passed back and forth to the flood shoal complex, which isn't represented really well here, to the ebb shoal, and you can sort of see these shallower areas here lining the inlet itself. Those are the flood marginal bars that I mentioned before, where I always see sand being passed back and forth, and that's kind of its own little roadway to get through. Sand suspended will go through the inlet, but the only pieces that I really see is actually in there. I know sand is being transferred between it.
Over 2 year time, is more sand leaving or more sand coming in?
For this particular inlet, we're in a dynamic equilibrium where the sand is kind of passing back and forth and then simply moving down drift. It's moving towards the south.
So it isn't changing over time to build a delta or to scour the channel?
No, there is some variability, and I didn't think of bringing some of my sediment budget stuff with me, but you can actually, if you're really interested and want to read a 110-page report, no, he doesn't want to read that. We actually detail all of that within the State of the Inlet reports that I mentioned that are publicly available as a product to the public. Unfortunately, that is the one piece I don't do. I do all of the modeling and all of the gauges. I don't do the sediment budget, so I don't have a really good feel for the numbers. I'm afraid if I give you a number, it's invariably going to be the wrong number.
More or less equalized. That's it.
Yeah, so it's in a dynamic equilibrium. Since the dredging of the sand trap, and we knew and we told them that, and they understood, and kind of welcome the answer that yes, you would throw it out of whack for a little while. And we did notice a loss of some seagrasses on the flood channel, or the flood shoal. There we go. Yes?
Are there a lot of inlets on the East Coast that this kind of analysis, this level of analysis applied to them?
The question is there a lot of inlets on the East Coast in the United States that have this level of analysis? I know that there's got to be some in the Carolinas. This is definitely the best one I've ever looked at and that I've ever worked with. I've had some pieces of information, some good stuff out of Grace Harbor in Washington, but no, this is definitely the most well-instrumented, well-studied inlet that I've ever looked at, and it's sort of spoiled me. So, but you know, now I definitely it's the data. That's what it comes down to. It without the data, I can't tell the district, and the district has been really open to data and trying things. There was I mentioned that we had some special stuff come up where they had asked us to take a look at a specific point within the inlet itself, kind of in this back area here called Coconut Point. They were having some problems with that, and so we took a special look at that and just made a model to see exactly what happened. And I put in some different alternatives, and what if we put in a groin and stuff like that, or a terminal groin, and we just ended up putting on coarser sand in order to hold it there. There was some other construction activities that had happened. So, and yes, sir.
Does this factor in the wind? Is that factored into this?
Winds are a model input, and luckily I have my own weather station here, and I use that actually more for model validation and verification. I actually drive it with WaveWatch 3 information, and I have actually a much larger grid in order to drive it with WaveWatch 3, and then I extract the waves and the winds out of that and then drive it my regional model with it. So there's a lot of, I didn't want to overwhelm everybody with too much modeling. Yes, in the back.
You're looking at the Merrimack. Mm. I also see evidence suggesting migration.
The question was, did I observe any sediment moving into the Great Marsh? I didn't see that directly in any of the data sets that I looked at, but it's certainly something that always could be looked at. And there was another question I missed. Hands went up too fast. Yes, in the back.
Yeah, I'm just curious, people talk a lot about natural forces, obviously.
Yes.
Any, just got to be more opinion, you don't know if you can model for the Merrimack on summer Saturday, it's like 1:28. So I'm just curious, what do you think with respect to motorized boat traffic?
The question was motorized boat traffic, and there actually is boat wake studies that are done at other places, and definitely from what I've seen at Sebastian, which is again a different wave climate, we actually have a much bigger basin back there. Wave traffic actually is a big factor, and we see that a lot. It could be a factor. It's really tough to tell. I think you could always put it into an analysis, and if it turns out that it's not that big a deal, then you've learned something. So even if when the question is no, this isn't right, you've still learned something. So it definitely should be looked into, and it's it would be within the realm of any model to be able to do that. Yes?
So I think you said earlier that the Sebastian Inlet is totally man-made. It wasn't there naturally.
Right.
And how do they choose that spot? Was it just luck that they bisect some water?
No. Let me back this up a couple. And it's a better image up at the front. There's actually a great dissertation by John Bishop, and he's a traditional geologist, where I am definitely not a geologist, I'm more of an engineer. These sections through here are relic shoals, so there was actually breaching of this barrier island, historically speaking. And I think it must have breached at one point, and I think the locals said, well, we would like an inlet here, please. And I guess there was an answer of no, and then they said, well, we would like an inlet here, please. And then it happened. So, but I wasn't around in 1919 to really understand it. But it's a common process within the barrier islands of Florida, where you have these migrating, breaching inlets that kind of come back and forth, operating on geologic time, not really on a decadal scale. Yes, in the back.
So I'm wondering if you can kind of give us a sense of, a relative sense of how important each one
Right.
And then if you can, how does the Sebastian compare to our river up here? Does the river have more of an influence in the coast?
I will separate that question into two sections like you did. So the first question was, talking about these different forcings, which one is more important than the other? And the irritating answer is all of them, and I don't know. And that's why, again, field data is more important, or very important rather, because it allows me to answer that question. So without local winds, without repeated bathymetric survey, or even nearshore waves, I don't actually know. So, and I haven't run the model for Merrimack myself. I set it up, and then I went down to Florida to start on Sebastian. In terms of Sebastian compared to Merrimack, in terms of its river influx, the back barrier system is actually 150 miles long, but we have such a small tidal range, and so that's why I'm having a tough time getting at your question as well for that second half, which one's more important. When I was out there earlier today, it was a very, very calm day, but I still saw a lot of flow going through the inlet, but I didn't see any solitons of waves, a single wave that's standing in the channel, standing upright. And I have that on a daily basis up at Sebastian. It doesn't matter what day it is, I still have white knuckles going through the inlet on the jet ski. So those waves are, I would think at Sebastian is an important thing. But this inlet is not as wide as yours, as Merrimack's. I think Merrimack's a little bit wider. I could probably measure that really quickly on Google Earth. So it's interesting. They're different, but they're similar. What I really wanted to do is just compare the approaches of the methodology of being able to understand the system comprehensively, because that's really what it is that it's a system, and we need to explore that system and study that system as a whole.
I want to thank Irene for all the information she presented. I think it was enlightening. And I also need to make an announcement that we have a donation fishbowl there, which helps us fund some of these programs and efforts that we do. And we're a volunteer organization, and that's kind of how we operate. So if you liked what you saw tonight, throw a dollar in the till. We won't pass the plate around, so have a volunteer bowl. But then I'd like to thank everybody for coming out tonight, and this is the last program we have this spring, and now we're going to have a few meetings and see what we can conjure up for the fall for programs. And so, check your emails in August and September. We'll have a schedule out, and you'll know what's coming up in the fall. But thanks for coming tonight.
Thank you.